Hello everyone, I'm Sushmita Sarkar, Assistant Professor, AAA Department, RV College of Engineering, Bangalore. Welcome you all in today's lecture 7 on over principle of over voltage protection. Fine, so in last few lectures, we have learned a lot of things about the transients. And we know that what are the main reasons behind these over voltages. And today in lecture, we will learn about what are the fundamental principles of these over voltage protection and what are the devices we use for this over voltage protection. So as you can see in this figure, you can see the operators are handling with one protective device, which is known as surge arresters. Fine, so we will learn about this more in today's talk. Fine, so here, first, let us learn about what are the fundamental principle of over voltage for a load equipment. You know, why do you require? Why these kind of protections? First of all, it's required because we know that the sources of over voltage can be a lightning strikes. It can be internal or it can be external. Fine. So when these are happening, so I need to control these over voltages, and to control or to limit this over voltages, we need certain protective devices, right? So now because these over voltages may cause malfunctioning of the equipment, or they may affect they may damage the sensitive insulations. So that is the main reason why do you want the protective devices for over voltage, right? So therefore, these protection devices must limit the voltage across the sensitive insulation. The first thing we should remember, that we should locate these kind of devices where you have very sensitive insulations in your power system. Fine, then you divert these currents, surge currents, fine, away from the load. So you have to divert them and give them a separate path where they should not reach to your load equipments and damage them. Fine, then block these currents by some means so they are not able to enter towards the load. Fine, then another thing, if your potential difference at the grounds are at a different level, you know, then there will be a certain type of flashover on the insulation. So for that reason, we should take care of these ground potential at the common one. So that's why we say bond the grounds together at the equipment. Fine, then reduce or prevent the surge currents flowing through the ground. Fine, you have to restrict, you have to put certain, you know, devices at both the ends of your ground wire such that you don't allow these surge currents to flow through through the ground wires. Fine, then you should create some sort of filters, low pass filters, using limiting and blocking characteristics such that they attenuate a high frequency noises. Fine, so with this basic principles, we know the devices which we use. Why do we require these protective devices? I've explained to you just now. And what are these devices, how they are different from each other, we will see in the next few slides. Fine, so the main function of these surge arresters and your TVSS. TVSS is nothing but transient voltage surge suppressors. Fine, so these both are almost, you know, in common terms, it will be used. Sometimes we talk about the surge arresters and sometimes we talk about TVSS because they are just used now and then in the common language when we talk in terms of a power system. So both are used basically to limit your maximum current, fine? So the current limits your maximum voltage, and these voltages, where it will occur, it will definitely occur between any two points in the circuit, fine? So now, usually we know that these kind of suppressors are used for what? To limit the maximum voltage into the system. And either you want to divert these such currents into the ground by offering them a low impedance path. But another point is there which we should keep it in mind, apart from their major function. You know, we also should remember that the location of these equipments, these devices, where we suppose, which is the best location where I can prevent or protect my equipments from such kind of surge currents or the over voltage transients. Fine. So these surge currents have to follow the same KCL as your normal currents follow. They need to follow from the same conductors, same circuit, and they will also offer the voltage drop across the conductors. They're nothing different from a normal currents. Only thing, they are just abnormally high. They are absolutely high currents, fine, due to the overvoltage transients. So how to control them, and what are the best possible way we can control them or protect our other equipments from these surge currents? So now we should keep it in mind that the ground point is always not at a zero potential. Okay, so there will be, especially when this transient takes place, the transient phenomena take place, the ground potential need not to be at zero point. Fine. So the surge suppressor device, so we should all, whenever we talk about these suppressors, surge suppressors, we also should keep that the ground point in our mind. Fine. So that ground point is very important. So we should provide certain type of, you know, surge suppressors near to these devices, near to these points also, with a minimum lead length all the terminals. Now, these common fine arrestors located at, basically they will be located at the main panels and the sub panels near to your loads centers, fine. But you will get a much more better results when these devices are located within itself the load equipment. But you know, always there is a cost comes into picture. But usually what we see is there should be a common point where there the loads are getting, you know, your power lines are entering into the load equipment, you can put your power surge arrestors in those particular locations. Fine. So let us understand this principle of overvoltage protection with the help of this simple diagram. So you can see over here. Okay, so we can see over here, there's a power source at this end. This is the load end. Another end is your load. And you have something in between that to protect. It is a protective phenomena of the device, which is called as a low pass filter equivalent. And apart from the low pass equivalent, what did I put? I put two suppressors at both the end. So both such suppressors are at the beginning of this low pass filter and after the low pass filter. So these both the low pass filters are having a surge current which are diverted towards the ground. Fine. So if there is a surge current striking the line, fine, the majority, the energy surge, you know, the current will be absorbed and diverted towards the ground with the suppressor one itself. The first arrestor will take care of it. After that, if there is anything, this will take care of the high surges. And then this low pass filter will take care of the high power frequency, which will help in attenuating the noises. If there is any other surge suppressors, any more surge suppressors left out, will be taken care by the second arrestor. And we see another thing near to the sensitive load, because it's not necessarily the lightning may strike over here, it can strike anywhere in your system. So in case of a failure of these arrestors, will also be taken care in the sensitive load system, where you can see that if the lightning strikes over here, there's a secondary path provided over here. Here you have something called as external signal cable. This is an external signal cable, which is bonded to the local ground reference. Fine. So even if there is a strike over here also, or if there are certain things which has not eliminated by the second suppressor, will be taken care by this signal cable. Fine. So these, the very important thing in this whole demonstration is that all the ground points should be at a common reference, you know, at the common point. Fine. Otherwise, the potential difference is high in one point and low in another point will cause a lot of problem into your system. That means it's basically, it'll come in terms of your flashover on the insulation cables, fine. So you have to keep it in mind that all the grounds are grounded at a common point level, so that if the ground point is getting high, that high potential is experienced by all the points. Fine. So with this, let us see. While lightning surge currents are seeking to remote ground reference, many transient overvoltage generated by switching will be those of a normal load angle. You not see ground. Many places where the lightning is striking, your ground point may not be available or it's not grounded properly. Fine. So in case where surge currents are diverted into the other load circuits, arrestor must be applied at each along the path to ensure the protection. So you should take care of that. The surge arrestors are provided at the load circuits too. Okay, not only at the transmission or the distribution points, but also at the load points, you have to provide them to ensure that the maximum protection is provided to the load equipments. Fine, so not that the signal cable is bonded to the load ground reference at the load just before the cable enters the cabinet. So we have just now, which what I have told you. So before that, the another protection has been taken care that you have given a signal cable which is bonded in the ground. Fine. It might seem that this creates, and you know, you would feel that is an unnecessary line which has been added into the system. But this particular signal cable is very, very important in terms of providing protection to the system. Fine, so a load in an environment where it is close to another load. So if in your environment, you know, all the loads are interconnected and all these loads are very much monitored by the operators, okay? And if there is any lightning strikes or any kind of overvoltage transients happen into the system, it will affect one ground to another ground. So we should, as I have told you, that this will affect yours. So all the ground should be bonded together for that reason. Fine. So this can cause a flashover across the insulation, which I've already discussed with you. So this flashover phenomena will come over across the insulation, that is between the two ground references, or cause physical harm to the operator who is operating with the line at that point of time. Fine. So thus, all ground reference conductors should be bonded together at the load equipment. So at the point of the load, all the ground points should be bonded together. So for that, what you require a safety of grounds, cable shields, cabinets, etc. All these comes under your, when you are talking about the safety matters. Next is the principle is, yeah. So when you talk about for providing, all the grounding points should be bonded together, it is not that you are talking about because you want to, you want that local ground references from rising the potential with a surge, with the lighting, that is impossible. You wanted to prevent your ground from the surge currents. So basically, when you say all the points you want to bond it together, that will not that it will prevent from lightning, because lightning will strike and the suppressor will pass this surge currents to the ground. So that is unavoidable. So the surge currents will come to the ground. So your main motto is not to stop the surge currents to come to the ground. The main motto is to see that all the ground potentials are at the same level. So which you can see over here, it's written over here. The next line says, rather the principle is to tie the reference together so that all power signal cable reference in the vicinity rise together. This phenomena is a common reason for failure of electronic devices. Fine. So when we find that there is a difference in the potential of the ground, so we can see that there will be a effect or the impact of this we can see in certain electronic devices. Fine. So I hope by this you have understood the what is the importance of bonding all the ground points together. Now, efforts to block the surge currents are most effective for high frequency surge. Yes, of course, yes. See, your main motto is to, to block the high frequency surges. So such as those originating, basically this high frequency surges, when I talk about, it's mainly due to the lightning. The low to medium surges, when I talk about, this is mainly due to the capacitive switching. Fine, so these high frequency surges, is something that since the power frequency, high frequency surges need to pass through the suppressors. Fine. So these suppressors will offer their minimal additional impedances, and it is difficult and expensive to build the filters which can differentiate between the low frequency and these high frequency. Fine. I hope you have understood. What I meant to say is your surge suppressors will be, your high currents will pass through the surge suppressors. So here, and these currents will be of very high frequency. So now here, if you want to add a filter, which is really difficult and it is expensive, that will help you to capable discriminate between low frequency and high frequency things, sound somewhat, because it's really expensive if you try to put in all the surge arrestors. Fine. In all the Sarge arrestors, if you want to put filters, inbuilt filters, then it is really becoming a difficult task, and economically also doesn't sound. So what happens? The blocking can be done relatively easily. So I should find out an easier method of how to block these high frequency waves. So what do you do this? The blocking can be done relatively easily for high frequency transients by placing an inductor or a chalk, as simple as that. Instead of going for a filter in the surge arrestors, it is much better to put an inductor or a chalk in series with a load. They will absorb the high surge voltages which are applied across them, fine? So that's the simplest way. So we always should find a solution which is more optimal and economical, you know? So next to what we see is, one must carefully consider that high voltage could damage the insulation of both the inductor and the load. So that thing should, by keeping that thing in mind only, you should design the inductor or the choke which you are going to put in series with the load. Fine, so the blocking function is frequently combined with the voltage limiting function. So you want to block, you want to limit, fine? So these two combination you supposed to provide. So this is provided in form of a low pass filter. So I am, the low pass filter I'm putting in between the suppressors. So I am putting simple principle, put the suppressors at both the end, in the middle you put the, you know, low pass filter, which will help you to attenuate this high frequency transients. So this will, some designs can be where you find that there is a shunt connected voltage limiting devices on either sides of your series choke, right? So that depends on different design aspects. So the line provides a blocking function in proportion to its length. So very important thing, this particular line will give you the blocking function proportion to the length. So such a circuit has very beneficial overvoltage protection characteristics. When you keep all the design aspects in your mind and then you come out with a solution, will definitely give you much more better characteristics of the system. So the inductance forces this bulk fast rising surges into the first arrestor. So the first arrestor will be taking care of that high surge energies, and the second arrestor then simply has to accommodate whatever the left out surge surge energies are there, which need to pass through that arrestor, fine? So such circuits are commonly built into outlet trips of the computer protection. So where we put those second suppressors also defined in this particular line. See, many such protection problems occurs because of the surge currents travels two or more separate connections to the ground. We are continuously discussing about that because it is very, very important to understand that if every point, if you have a different ground potential, then it is, and these ground points are not bonded together, it will cause a lot of problems into the system. So this is a particular problem with lightning protection because lightning currents are seeking ground and basically divide according to the ratios of impedances which is provided to this path, fine? So basically what the lightning arrestor does, and where do we exactly place this lightning arrestors? When I talk about the lightning arrestors into the power system practically, then you know the most costliest and very expensive equipment which you have in your power system is a transformer. Transformers, I will show you also in one of the pics where it is, you know, you can see the surge arrestors are in before and after your transformers because you need to protect these transformers from these high overvoltage transients. Fine, so therefore, we also need to take care, so not only the location of the surge arrestors in the power system, but also need to take care how these surge arrestors diverting the currents to the ground and how they're providing the path for these currents to go to the ground and how these ground points are bonded together. The surge current does not even have to enter the power or phase conductors to cause the problems. There will be a significant voltage drop along the ground conductors, obviously, because when there is such a high current passing through these arrestors, definitely there will be a voltage drop, you know. So that will frequently appear across the critical insulation. You can feel that, you know, you can sense that voltage drop across your ground cable. So the grounds involved may be entirely within the load facility or some of the grounds may be on the utility system. There would be only one ground path for lighting within a facility, or many facilities have multiple paths. So you have provided one facility for the lightning strike, but that particular facility may have multiple paths for the current to flow beneath the ground. Fine. So the amount of current flowing between the grounds may be reduced by, how do you reduce it? So we have to see that we avoid the, even the, how you are avoiding the surge currents in your power system to flow. Similarly, you have also protect your ground wires from these surge currents. So you need to improve your ground potentials. You need to improve your, you know, ground insulations and provide some protective devices at both ends of the ground wire terminals, so that these surge currents does not find a path to flow over there. So the amount of current flowing between the grounds may be reduced by improving all the intentional grounds at the service entrance and nearby on the utility system. This will normally reduce but not eliminate, obviously. See, you cannot, these currents are at very high level and you cannot reduce them to zero. You can just reduce the intensity of this currents in your ground wires. So try to reduce it, eliminating is quite difficult. Fine. So however, some structures also have significant lighting exposure. Okay. So, and the damaging surge currents can flow back into the utility grounds. So it doesn't matter which direction the current flows, they cause the same problem. Doesn't matter what is the flow of your current, which is the direction of your current. So it is going to give you the same impact. When it is impractical to keep the currents from flowing between the two grounds, both the ends of the power or signal cables running between the two grounds must be protected with voltage limiting devices to ensure adequate protection. Exactly, that is what I have told you. So come out with a practical solution. Provide a voltage limiting devices at both the ends of the grounding cables, so that it can give you the maximum protection and reduce the surge currents flowing in the ground wires. So this is a common practice for the utility as well as that end user, where we see these, the control cabinet is located some distance from the switch or being controlled at a different point. Fine. So with this, I hope the basic principle that why do we need to provide the voltage protection, overvoltage protection, and how do we do that? What is the basic concept? So I hope you have understood the basic concept of providing the overvoltage protection is not only above the ground, but also below the ground. So you need to take care of these currents in both the places, and you do so with the help of your suppressors and in between the, by putting the low pass filters, fine. So next we move on to, you know, devices for over voltage protection. So what are the different devices? Quite interesting. What are the different devices? Because we all want to know in terms of practical applications. Fine. So we are continuously hearing surge arrestors and nothing but your lighting arrestors. Fine. So how they look, what is exactly how it operates, what is the basic classification or the principle behind this? So let us see. Fine. So what happens? So let these surge kind of suppressors, or, you know, these kind of suppressors, what you are seeing on your screen, we usually see at the load end. Fine. So these suppressors are what? They are the arrestors, or I call them as a transient voltage surge suppressors devices. They protect the equipment from limiting the very high voltages. So these TVSs are generally used at the load equipment end, as I told you. So this will have more surge limiting elements compared to the arrestors. So basically TVSs will have more current limiting elements than the surge arrestors, and they are most commonly consist of, MOV blocks. What are these MOV blocks? They are the maximum operating voltage blocks. Fine. So they are max, they are able to handle the maximum operating voltage. So they are consist with this MOV blocks. So whereas when you talk about the arrestors, so arrestors will have a high energy handling capability. Fine, they can withstand a very high energy level surges. Fine, so that is what the how arrestor is different from your TVSs. So remember, TVSs will have more current limiting elements, whereas surge arresters will have high handling, energy handling capacity, okay, of the surges. So the elements that make up these devices, okay, now we are talking about the elements which make up these devices can be classified into different modes of operation, which we call it as a crowbar or a clamping device. So it's a very interesting name when we talk about a crowbar and a clamping device. So let us see what is this crowbar device and a clamping device. Okay, so what happens in a crowbar device? Crowbar device is basically, it will be an open stage, you know, open state. So they are the open device and they start conducting only when the overvoltage transients will occur. And what happens when this overvoltage transients occur? These particular devices will bring the voltage near to zero or equal to zero. So once the device starts conducting, so the question comes when the device starts conducting, whenever there is a transients are taking place, overvoltage transients are taking place. So if whenever there are surge currents like that, so the device starts conducting, otherwise device will be usually open. Please keep it in mind. These are the devices in normal operating stage, they will be in open condition. One such kind of phenomena comes into picture, this device will start conducting and the line voltage will drop to zero or near to zero due to the short circuit imposed across the line. So automatically voltage will come to zero. So you can see the device will get triggered and it will just come to zero or near to zero. And once it clears, it comes back to the normal voltage, fine? So what is the disadvantage of such kind of system? So the such kind of system will what happen? This will go below the operating voltage region. And what will happen? This may go for a few cycle, half a cycle, but this will almost trip your certain loads unnecessarily. So that is one big disadvantage in terms of crowbar devices. You know, so these devices are usually manufactured with gap filled with air or a special gas. So what will happen? So these gap arcs, when sufficiently have a, this gap arcs over, when a sufficiently high over voltage transient appears, as I've explained to you just now. So once the gap arcs is over, usually the power frequency current or the power current flows will continue to flow in the gap until the next current zero reaches or comes. Okay, so these devices have the disadvantages that I, as I've explained you, the power frequency voltage drops to zero. You know, the power frequency voltage falls down to zero almost for a half cycle. So this will cause a certain loads to trip off unnecessarily. So that is one biggest advantage in case of a crowbar devices. Now next, second device is something called as a clamping device. What does this clamping device do? This clamping device in normal operating condition will conduct for a very low current, you know. So this is basically a non-linear device, non-linear resistor device. So what happens? So such devices for AC circuits are commonly non-linear resistors that conduct very low amount of currents until an overvoltage occurs. So if you, it is under a normal operating operation of the system is going on, then a very less current will flow through this device. But when the overvoltage occurs, then what will happen? They start conducting very heavily, you know. So immediately they start conducting very heavily and their impedances drop rapidly with the increase of voltage. So you can see it look like something like this. Basically, you are clamping the voltage and bring it back. So what will happen? These devices effectively conduct increasing amounts of current to limit the voltage rise to surge. So you are, because you are providing at that time, you know, because your impedance drops rapidly with the increase of voltage, and due to that reason and a heavy current will start flowing through it. So basically you are preventing your rest of the system from this surge currents. They have an advantage over the crowbar devices is that the voltage is not reduced to zero in this case. So this looks much better than your previous case. They are not allowing the voltage to come near to the zero. So the parameter or the equipment which we use for certain applications, in majority cases, we use Zener diode, okay? Okay, next we come to the isolation transformers. So when we look into the isolation transformers, as the name indicates, it isolates from the power system to the load. You know, if there is any fault or any surge, any transients are happening at your distribution line, so you are able to, you know, isolate that it from your load. So basically it is acting as a protective device. So basically what they do, they also help in attenuating the high frequency, you know, the currents. So what happens over so here you can see here the transformers with the electrostatic shields are provided, which will help you to attenuate the noises. So isolation transformer used to attenuate high frequency noise and transients as they attempt to pass from one side to another. An electrostatic shield is effective in eliminating common mode noises. However, some normal mode noise can still reach the load due to magnetic and capacitive coupling. So there will be a noise, but majority, the maximum noise will be eliminated with the help of this electrostatic shielding of isolation transformer. Yes, the main characteristics of the isolation transformer for electrically isolating. Okay, so I hope everybody is very much familiar about the word an isolation transformer. So basically it will be electrically isolating from the load, from the system for transient. And it does by, is that the main thing is they are able to do it with the help of the leakage inductance. Fine. So this leakage inductance plays a very important role, which will help in reducing the high frequency noise and transient from reaching it to the load. And if it is present in the load, then it will prevent from the load to the rest of the system. So one of the example is, you can see that voltage notching due to power electronic switching is one of the example of a problem that can be limited to the load side by an isolation transformer. So this voltage notching phenomena, which you have studied in your module one, where you can understand that that phenomena in the electronic devices can be eliminated with the help of these type of isolation transformer. Next, what we see, the next device of overvoltage protection is a low pass filter. We have already talked about these low pass filters. So I have just shown you some pic from the website I have taken, and you can see that how the low pass filter looks, practically. So low pass filters achieve even better protection for higher frequency transients. You know, so that is, I already told you that the function of the inductor and the function of capacitor, what they're basically doing it. So this LC combination provides a low impedance path to ground for selected resonant frequencies. So what they do, this protection usages, voltage clamping devices are, because you will see many places, many designs, those who use this clamping devices with the help of, you use the devices in parallel with these capacitors. So you are using the clamping devices and also you are using the capacitors in order to protect this equipment from the surges. So we will see one simple hybrid transient protector. So if you look into this hybrid transient protector, you can see over here that I have used two suppressors, and in between I have used a low pass filter. So this suppressor, which is of the type gap type protector. So this is a gap type. So we have just now seen one gap type protector is your crowbar. Fine suppressor. So what happens over here, this gap type protectors will be able to, you know, absorb the high energy transients. So this will absorb the high energy transients. This is going to take care of the high frequency transients. So if anything is left out, will take taken care by your MOVs. So these MOVs are going to take care of the rest of the surge energies which are left out. So you can see that the figure shows a common hybrid protector that combines two such suppressors and a low pass filter to provide maximum protection. The combination is itself like that. That is the basic principle we have learned, that if you design it something like that, that will provide you the maximum protection to the system. It uses a gap type protector, which you have seen at the front end. I have used a gap type protector to handle the high energy transients. Then I have used a low pass filters to transfer the high frequency transients. And then inductor, in this low pass filter, the inductor will help you to block the high frequency transients and forces them into the first suppressor. So what it does, it will not allow the high frequency transients will be blocked by this inductor. It will not allow to pass further. And so that they are forced to be controlled by your first suppressor itself. So the capacitor limits the rate of the rise of current with non-linear resistor MOV, which clamps the voltage magnitude at the protected equipment. So you know the function of the MOV, that is my, basically this side is my crowbar device, and another end I'm using a clamping device, and in between I have kept a low pass filter to give the maximum protection to the rest of the system. Next, another device is low impedance power conditioners, right? So low impedance power conditioners, how does it look? It looks like this, fine. So what they do? So low impedance power conditioners are usually used with your SMPS, that is your switch mode power supplies, which we usually see in electronic devices. So they are basically interface with each other, and they are differ from your isolation transformers in that these conditions have a much lower impedance. So these LiPCS use a much lower impedance and have a filter as a part of their design. So your isolation transformer does not have any filter inbuilt. Fine. So isolation transformer is a isolation transformer itself. You don't have any filter added to it. But in case of a low impedance power conditioners, they first of all provide a very low impedance path. And second thing, they are in their design, they also add the filters. Okay. So you can see a simple low impedance power conditioner shown over here. So this is basically offering a very low impedance path, and it's just, you can see how it is looking like. So the filter is on the output side, protect against high frequency, source side common mode and normal mode disturbances. So basically this LiPCS takes care of the noises and the transients or this impulse transients by providing a low impedance path and with the help of the filters. Fine, so these are, however, low to medium frequency transients can cause problems for LiPCS. So this is because LiPCS are mainly, we are taking care of the high frequencies. So that when you come to a low frequencies, or when I talk to low to medium frequencies, I'm talking about a capacitor switching. So there it may not fit properly. So the transients in those particular cases can be magnified by the output filter capacitor. So for that, you can just put in another output filter at the end. Fine, next we come to the last device or the last topic of today's lecture is the utility surge arresters. So as I told you, I will discuss over here, how does the actually, when we put it on the, when we teach the theory, the student does not get the practical scenario. Where do I use it in my power station? So you can see you can see the dark color, not the light one, the dark one, this one. So you can see this is a transformer. As I told you, transformer is the most, very costliest device and very important equipment for the power system. So this needs an extra protection. So whether the incoming line from the transformer and the outgoing of the transformer should have these surge arresters. So you can see one, two, three phases. So you can see the surge arresters. There are the three phases surge arresters you can see over here. And similarly at the back side, this one, another one is hidden. So there are three like this at the back end also. There is nothing but these are the incoming lines or these are the outgoing line or vice versa. So this will be there in incoming line as well as the outgoing line of the transformer because it needs to be extra protected. These are very, very, important and costly equipments in the power system. So what do we see? The three most common surge arrester technologies employed by the utilities. So you can see one is your gap silicon carbide. This is quite old technology, but still such kind of, the arresters are still present in our power system. So this is quite older technology. And then it comes with a gapless MOV. So this is, as the name says, you have the gap, resistance graded gap structures. But here you provide a gapless MOV. So this is as commonly it has taken the full market, it has been taken. Right now, most of the utilities are installed with these gapless MOVs. Fine. And for particular applications or certain applications, we used this gapped MOV. So remember, this is a gapless and this is gapped MOV. So gapped MOV is nothing but it's a combination of the first two. So basically, it is a combination of the first two and will be utilized for certain applications. So both the A and B combination, both this and this combinations, you know, characteristics were combined and put it in one and used for certain applications. So most manufacturers today use MOV as the main voltage limiting element. The chief ingredient of MOV is a zinc oxide. Yes, so what do you use in this MOV? Basically, you use a zinc oxide, which is combined with the several proprietary ingredients to achieve the necessary characteristics and the durability. Similarly, we see that other, as I told you, SiC is the silicon carbide is the older technology, but still you will find them in few of the power systems. Gaps are necessary because this is an important thing. So gaps are necessary in case of SiC because an economical SiC element giving the required discharge voltage is unable to withstand continuous system operating voltage. So be something we call it as, you know, MOCV, okay, or MCO, that is your maximum continuous over voltage. So, you know, so if your over voltage is continuous, for that, these SiC elements require a gap. So gaps are necessary with SiC because an economical SiC element giving the required discharge voltage is unable to withstand. Find they're unable to withstand those continuous system operating voltages. So with that needs a requirement of the development of MOV technology that caused and this particular technology to come into picture. So this this has eliminated the requirement of gap. So this technology could withstand that continuous operating voltage without the gaps and still providing discharge voltage comparable better than your SiC arresters. Fine, by the late 1980s, almost all SiCs are displaced, all SiCs are replaced by your MOV technologies. So the gapless MOV provided a somewhat better discharge characteristics without the objection spark over transient. The majority of the utility use this type of equipments. Now coming to the gapped MOV technology. The gapped MOV technology was introduced commercially about 1990 and has gained acceptance in some applications where there is need for increased protective margins. As I told you, it is a combination of the previous two. And this is used for certain applications where, you know, the protection becomes a very huge phenomenon. It is very, very important to give the protection at the first end. So therefore, you use for very certain applications. Okay, so by combining resistance graded gaps, that is your SiC and MOV blocks, this arrestor technology has some very interesting and counterintuitive characteristics. It has a lower lightning discharge voltage, but has a high transient voltage withstand characteristics than a gapless MOV arrestor. So these are few characteristics of your gapped MOV. So to achieve the required protective level for lightning, gapless MOV arrestors typically begin to conduct heavily for low frequency transients to about 1.7 per unit. So we should keep these four points in mind regarding whenever we are talking about gapped MOV. Fine. So now we come to an end and that's a quiz time. So I'm just going to ask you a very simple question. So if you're attentive to today's lecture, then I'm very, very sure that you are able to answer all these quiz questions. Fine. So guys, this quiz questions will help you to understand the subject and just to revise the whole today's lecture. It's fine. A lightning arrestor provides, why do you require a surge arrestors in your system? What does it provide? Fine. So basically, yes, tell me. Yeah, I know you know, all of you know the answer that what does the lightning arrestor do? So exactly, it provides a low impedance path between the line and the ground during the operation. Whenever there's a striking happening or the over voltage condition is happening, so it is providing a low impedance path. Basically, a lightning arrestor is an absorber, it is a diverter, it is a reflector. What it is? Basically, a lightning arrestor is a diverter. So it is a surge diverter. Okay. Next, surge arrestors are used in power system to protect electrical equipments against. Surge arrestors are used in power system to protect electrical equipments against power frequency over voltages. Throughout the lecture, we are only talking about this term, high power frequency over voltage transients. Okay. So this surge arrestors basically are used to prevent from these power frequency over voltages. Next, the main function of surge arrestors and TVS is to limit what? Something which appears between two points in the circuit. Okay. So I hope all of you know this simple question. Answer is voltage. So all these surge arrestors and the transient voltage surge suppressors are used to limit the voltage that will appear between the two points. Dash are normally open devices that conduct current during over voltage transients, which is a device we were talking about, which will act as an open device when in under a normal condition. Remember? Yes, very good. It is, I think many of you know the answer already. So that is a crowbar device. So crowbar device, which is normally will be in open state. And once it starts conducting, and it will conduct whenever the short circuit takes place on the line, it will conduct and it will drop the voltage to zero or near to zero. And that is the biggest disadvantage of this particular device, because this particular action will simply trip few of the loads unnecessarily, because the voltage level will go below the normal level of voltage. Okay. An isolation transformer used to attenuate. What does isolation transformer? Why do you use isolation transformer? It is used to attenuate high frequency noise and transients. Okay. So I hope it is clear. An isolation transformer is used to attenuate high frequency noise and transients, and it does so with the help of electrostatic shielding. Okay. Don't forget that point. It does so with the help of electrostatic shielding. The next question. Dash combines two surge suppressors and a low pass filter to prove maximum protection. Dash combines two surge. I was telling you continuously the principle of the over voltage protection, and I was telling you that the two suppressors will be there. We have seen one figure where you have one and you have the surge suppressor just crowbar, and another surge suppressor was your clamping, and in between you had a low pass filter. What is that? What is that device? Okay, that is a hybrid protector. So that is called as a hybrid protector, which combines two surge suppressor and a low pass filter to prove maximum protection. Okay. Devices for dash devices for an AC circuit are commonly non-linear resistors that conduct very low amount of currents until an over voltage occurs. So which is the device which is non-linear resistor? Just remember that sign, non-linear resistors that conducts. So in simple, I hope many of you know the answer already. It is in a normal state, it will allow a very low current. But once it starts conducting, whenever the voltage transient strikes on it, it starts conducting, and then it will be start conducting very, very heavily. So impedance will fall down. And what will happen? Impedance will fall down. So which system will do so? Will make you to, it will absorb a lot of high voltages across it. Okay, that is your clamping device. So you should know the difference between your crowbar and clamping device. What is the advantage of clamping device, guys, over the crowbar device? Okay, what is the clamping device has advantage? That it will never bring the voltage near to zero or close to zero also. The main characteristics of isolation transformer for electrically isolating the load from the system for transient is there. I have highlighted also that in the my PPT, you know, that is what is the main characteristics of isolation transformer. How does it electrically isolate it from the load from the system for transients? What is that playing a role? Okay, that is leakage inductance. The answer is leakage inductance. Okay, with this we have come to the end of today's lecture. I hope all of you have really learned something from today's lecture, and hoping to see you soon in my next lecture. Thank you. Bye. Take care.